art following money is a timeless cycle that has more to do with economics than art. For with wealth comes culture. But what happens when the money runs out?
Mr. David Bing.
So pleased to see you all out here for something that's so very, very important, not only to the city of Detroit, but for this entire region.
Please vote yes and support the DIA. Thank you so very much.
Happy Wednesday to the best school in DTS.
Let's go. Good morning. Ari, Sharonda, did you bring me your field trip slip?
What are some things that we're going to see today when we go to the DIA?
We'll see art or like portraits.
Right, we're going to see paintings. We'll see sculptures. How did they get these things that we're going to see today? People have collected over the years all different types of art. So they leave that to people so that we can go down to the DIA and that we can appreciate it. Why would people want students like you to come to the DIA and learn? What is it that they're trying to get you to see?
Showing people how people live and
survive. Showing people how other cultures live.
Picture an image of Detroit. What comes to mind? The once great motor city, a city on the brink of collapse, or a city with one of the six greatest fine art collections in the United States.
I have frequently heard expressions that vary on the theme of, I had no idea that Detroit had anything like the DIA.
It's the Detroit image that it doesn't fit with, and it especially doesn't fit now because we're supposed to be a city in ruins.
That's the glory of the past, but that's what this museum in a way represents most vividly. We were the first art museum in America to acquire a Van Gogh in 1920. We were the first art museum in America to acquire a Matisse in 1922. We have the finest collection of Italian sculpture in the Western Hemisphere. We're still the only major art museum to have a department of African American art, completely forgetting that in the first three decades of the last century, Detroit was this amazing powerhouse with extraordinary wealth.
How is it that the DIA has this really top-notch collection, and how do those defining moments relate to not only the history of Detroit, but also to the history of America? Art follows money.
Today, pop culture may look to its two coasts, but America's Midwestern cities have never been defined solely as car towns or sports towns.
Beyond the dreams of his ancestors, modern man has molded the earth to his liking.
And thanks to the Industrial Revolution 100 years ago, art museums inspired by European designs cropped up in Midwestern cities, almost in lockstep. Awash in a cultural inferiority complex, and before urban planning, Americans looked to the City Beautiful School of Design to create cultural pride in their cities. While small groups of newly rich industrialists endowed their new museums with the finest treasures money could buy.
Hey, Mr. Kane, there's a lot of pictures and statues in Europe you haven't bought yet.
You can't blame me, Mr. Bernstein. They've been making statues for 2,000 years, and I've only been buying for 5.
Newly wealthy Detroiters founded the Detroit Institute of Arts to enrich the city's growing population. But just as our definition of art broadened in the 19th century, so too would our definition of the American experience in the 20th.
I think the Fords and the industrial leaders who helped make the DIA a reality, they were visionaries. They knew that everybody could appreciate art. But as we've evolved and as big cities have become more diverse, we've got to explore new ways to make museums and cultural institutions like the DIA particularly relevant and worthy to be sustained.
In recent years, with urban population declining and demographics shifting, art museums find themselves facing an identity crisis. Many public institutions, originally founded for the people and by the people, now find themselves stereotyped as stuffy and elitist.
Funders no longer want to support institutions that are considered elitist. This is a very dangerous thing for us. And elitism is the ticket to making that happen.
A 19th century invention, art history has its roots in the opinions of art collectors, scholars, and critics, and not objective analysis.
Traditional forms of painting and sculpture have no function in our streamlined existence.
What's ending and what's beginning in your world? Just take 5 minutes.
With the DIA offered as a benchmark, in 2012, representatives from America's leading art museums gathered near Detroit to wrestle with their biggest problem, attracting new audiences.
Our institution, our programs, our collections, our online experience, I think all of that is important. I think the art part isn't bringing them in. It's not bringing them in, and I don't think it can be the art
part. But the idea is that even if you bring them in with the other stuff, ultimately your goal is the art. So that's your goal.
The goal is the art, but it's not. But art isn't crucial to their lives. And I don't know that it ever is going.
Acquiring an object and putting it in a vault or putting it in a gallery isn't enough.
Traditionally, curators have, you know, without even realizing it, they're speaking to their collegial audience. They're speaking to other curators. They're not necessarily speaking to the public. There's a way of doing that, but I think they need help.
I think that there's a general consensus that we're a field in crisis and that our business model doesn't work and we can't keep going the way we're going. Things have to change.
Long before many institutions were aware of this problem, Detroit's DIA had already begun work to reconnect with their public.
Detroit doesn't have tourists. We work for our own community.
The world has changed, and visitorship has changed.
The realization that the museum voice was what needed to change was a gradual realization for me.
People feel that they're going to fail museum because they walk in and they go, I don't know how to act, I don't know how to dress, I don't know how to look at that particular object and understand it, and so I'm going to fail.
Did you see the steel cube?
Yeah, that was the worst. Now that was brilliant to me, absolutely brilliant.
The steel cube was brilliant?
It was very textural, you know what I mean? It was perfectly integrated and it had a marvelous kind of negative capability.
Art is inherently contentious because it represents culture. And culture is very contentious. Who owns culture? Who defines it?
When they show someone in a portrait with a flower, that's what they were showing, that the person was engaged to be married. Betrothed means that they were intended to get married. That's another word for saying they were engaged.
The art is there. It's going to be there. It sits there. It's unchanging. But the visitor is the active part. The role of the museum is to make that bridge.
If you go to an art fair, you're experiencing art. If you buy something at that art fair that really makes you happy day after day when you see it, you're experiencing a transformation.
When a work of art starts a dialogue of different people thinking different things, that is magic. That's why this collection and the art objects at the DIA are so alive. They are not dead. They are always telling us new stories, and there is always something new to learn from.
People don't realize that they live in this intensely visual culture. And what I feel like my job is to help them decode the language of lines, language of colors. Everyone has a reaction to it, but it's that you're not schooled in it because we are a very text-based society. And people don't realize is that they are responding to visual stimuli. Even if you can have Google Art, even if you can have 360-degree views, nothing replaces the experience of being in front of an object. Nothing can approximate that scale.
The Vatican Museums had a symposium in 2006. And you had museum directors, British Museum, from the Louvre, from the Cairo Museum, and from Detroit. And we were all talking about the same things in different ways. We were talking about how do we engage our public. And the Louvre conducted a survey that showed that an alarming percentage of their French visitors didn't particularly relate to classical art, and that they couldn't interpret Leonardo's Madonna of the Rocks, that they thought it was a family at a picnic. And the director of the British Museum said, well, you know, that's not a bad place to start talking about that painting. In other words, he was saying, you know, that's what people bring with them, that's where you start.
In the 90s, Graham Beal left a directorship in LA, not only to take over one of the most important art collections in the US, but also to fulfill his belief that the power of art should be accessible to visitors from all walks of life.
My personal background is a little bit complicated, but I grew up in a class-conscious society and experienced a degree of discrimination. You get that shading, you have a sense of places that you're not, you know, you're not really supposed to be, you know, and can be treated with disdain by other people. So we didn't have much money in my family, so museums being free, art museums especially, was very, very important. And my father was a journeyman electrician. He was dying from World War II. And when I was a little boy, he would go to London to see the specialist that was trying to treat his wartime injuries. And we go to the National Gallery. I remember one time asking my father, what is this, or I don't understand this. And he basically felt comfortable in saying, well, nor do I. But, you know, we now know through our research that the interaction between family members helping one another is one of the best ways for opening up. People who trust one another, talking to one another, able to say things to one another that they wouldn't admit, like my father saying, I've no idea what that's supposed to be. But yeah, I mean, I remember going into the National Gallery and sort of looking around at all of these paintings and thinking, wow, this is fantastic. I can just come in here and look around and somehow having a sense that it was my museum.
Our director likes to say that she has no doubt that art is relevant to everyone's lives. Our challenge is to demonstrate that relevance.
That's right.
I mean, you have to know what your customers are thinking and what they are saying. You know, I think the very best way to predict the future is to create it.
The future of the Detroit Institute of Arts, that's our topic today on Spotlight, and we're joined by the new director of the DIA. So then what becomes the goal for Graham Beal? What challenges?
The challenge really is to make the collection, the word really is accessibility, to make that collection available and open and accessible to as wide a public as possible in a way that I think has not been done in the past. Not only here, not only in Detroit, but in other cities as well.
Soon after Graham came aboard, the museum had to attend to critical structural repairs, replacing outdated wiring, infrastructure concerns, and an unexpected $40 million asbestos problem.
When you first meet Graham, you might not think he is a risk taker, but clearly when we did the reinstallation in 2007, he took bigger risks than almost anybody in the art world has taken in a long time.
But the new director found that rehanging the art could also be a make or break career opportunity. Modernizing the visitor experience.
We had this huge master plan that called for all the galleries to be emptied, but somewhat to my amusement, because it was being handled from an operational point of view,
not very much thought had been given to the fact that, well, yeah, everything's going to have to be put back, too.
It wasn't about not doing art history in the reinstallation, but about abandoning an academic approach to art history.
When Nancy brought me into education, most of us were art historians who were doing public programming and who were doing school tours. And that's great, and those are really important programs. But adding to the art history, real knowledge, deep knowledge of the visitor experience to lead an interpretive area within an education department in an art museum, nobody was doing that.
There's a bigger picture of that same work up on the screen now, too.
A former curator himself, new director Graham Beal shocked the museum establishment by supporting the DIA's educators' push to incorporate visitor feedback into the design of exhibits.
Basically use our imagination.
It influences how you think and how you feel. And
I remember him coming to some of the visitor panels and becoming a champion of that, becoming a champion of talking to visitors and hearing what they had to say. That was huge.
I was watching a very accomplished docent touring a group of third graders. They were looking at Cézanne's Mont Saint-Victoire, and she started talking to them about why Cézanne was the grandfather of modernism. And I was shocked and stunned that there was so little understanding of how to talk appropriately to any audience about works of art.
Experts in art education, now called the Learning and Interpretation Department, joined the DIA staff to work directly with curators to update the museum's voice.
It used to be a very slender group of participants who would design galleries, an architect, a designer, a curator. So you introduce these interdisciplinary teams.
The idea of the exhibition now is that visitors vote on two different labels.
Traditionally written by professional art historians, the curators, the labels in an art museum will reflect a museum's voice.
It's amazing how much our curators know about the different objects in the collection, but you can't impart all of that to a visitor in one moment, in one label.
In Europe and in the institutions I worked before, the installations have been always historically oriented until I came to the DIA. And it was an eye-opener for me. I collaborate with the Learning and Interpretation Department as much as I can, and I love to do it. We have seen people more interested about the hairdo and the shawl and the fashion of the woman.
You want there to be enough room somewhere in that label for people to discover something else.
What people are trying to do when they look at works of art is to figure out what's going on in the images. If it's an object, what was it for?
It's one thing for a person to say something to you. It's another learning experience to actually touch and feel.
Good practice is making art accessible, making the curators or the museum's ideas accessible. Best practice is elevating it to relevance and meaningfulness.
It was always clear that what we were doing was kind of cutting edge for art museums. So we had to be thoughtful in how we grew our audience, how we connected with people. We had to look at ways we were getting in the way of ourselves.
Basically what happens is you have the visitor voice in your head all the time. So you're developing something and you're hearing what the visitor is thinking about that.
The DIA's research uncovered many areas for improvement, starting with shorter, easier to understand labels.
Labels are only 50 words, and that is also a challenge, but also a beautiful challenge, because if in those 50 words you are able to say something that is interesting and the visitor, when reading it, has understood something about that work of art, I think we have fulfilled our mission.
Everyone who works in an art museum will tell you that it's the director that really sets the tone.
The underlying theme usually has to do with some kind of shared human experience. We introduce Rubens as an artist who was a man who loved women, he loved God, and this is what motivated him. Worship and relationships are things that every human being understands, and that's what we build on.
Breaking with museum tradition, the reinstallation cleared the way for the transformative power of the DIA's art to reach younger, wider audiences.
What happens with kids and art, and kids in the world, it's a really unmediated kind of directness of perception. They're soaking it all in. And then I think as we grow older, we tend to compartmentalize. Teenagers or even adults can say, oh, well, art doesn't have anything to do with me.
This is the painting, Rembrandt Beal, called The Court of Death. And this will basically be in darkness. There'll be tea lights on the floor.
Here's this institution that's 127 years old now. How does it begin to be a little bit more nimble? How does it react? Because there's stuff that's relevant in there. So how can we create these kind of cool opportunities? And how do we extend the invitation? And then that led this year to this idea of sleepwalkers.
And so they'll be wandering various routes. I'm not even sure which exact route. But the idea is that it'll take them past the galleries.
You're transforming the museum into something that people haven't seen before. And creating that sense of exploration and wonder, it gets back to those kind of qualities that we try to inspire.
Museums are places that spark creativity. We are places that spark innovation. So I hope that other museums look at it that way. I think that that's a challenge, though, because it's difficult to shake up everything you knew and throw it out for the public to pass judgment on.
And though the DIA's reinstallation changes were embraced by visitors, some traditional art critics call them radically populist.
There were people who, before they had even seen what we did in the galleries, were accusing us of turning the DIA into DIA Disney. We were dumbing down the collection. We weren't having respect for the art.
Most of the knee-jerk attacks on what people thought we were doing here came from critics, just an assumption that if we were abandoning the framework of art history and if we were thinking in terms of visitor behavior, then Disneyfication was on the way. Those are the old owners of museums.
It's not dumbing down, it's getting smarter about how you do this.
I believe very deeply it's because we had so much visitor input and evaluation along the way. It turned into something we couldn't have imagined and that set a standard for the field.
I get calls on a regular basis from other museums who want to talk to our interpretive staff, who want to see how we're doing things in Detroit.
A show with Russia's Fabergé eggs put the DIA's exhibition team to the test, making symbols of decadent elitism relevant to Detroiters, now experiencing the worst depression since the 1930s.
When we first started planning, Occupy Wall Street just had broken out, and we're looking at these objects that were created for the 1% over a century ago.
My background in post-colonial lit and theory and gender studies is all about finding the gaps, like whose voice isn't represented, what are other perspectives.
At the end of the day, working with L&I is what story is going to appeal to our visitors. And it's really a matter of, you know, hashing out these possibilities. Why not try to get the replica that was used in the filming of Ocean's 12? I think looking at its reception and popular culture is no less valid than researching the archives.
And we ask their opinion, and we ask, what do you think about this? They fall a little bit in love. This becomes theirs.
Thank you.
Let's look at what's happened to the Motor City, Detroit. The auto industry and the city have been under assault for decades. Now, the recession and what could be a knockout punch. The big three U.S. car makers lost more than $52 billion last year.
We could never charge enough for an exhibition ticket to cover the cost of the exhibition.
We've got to make hard choices. Unfortunately, very often, facilities or institutions like the DIA become a nice to do versus a need to do.
The word is, this is our Webster.com, endowment. Does anybody know what that word means? Something that is endowed. That's the part of an institution's income derived from donations. That means that someone has left this institution either artworks or collections of things. All right, so that's what we're talking about. So right now, let's write down endowment because I want this one on your paper. Here you go.
This institution is endowment poor, and that is frequently attributed to a kind of approach that can go back to Henry Ford.
There was a bias against contributing to endowment, and so that history has built up.
The museums that can support themselves are the ones with the big, unrestricted operating endowments. And there are many other museums in this country that get 50, 60% of their annual operating from mill levies, often going back to the beginning of the 20th century with the City Beautiful, that have long-standing millages that people don't even know they're renewing when they go to the polls, that have been supporting them since 1910.
This is Motor City, and you know, we've celebrated the Motor City, and we've been over-relying on the Motor City, so we sort of assume that between General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler, many of our issues would be solved. We do need to diversify not only our job base, but our donor base.
After weighing all the options, in 2012, the DIA and its supporters came to the conclusion that a dedicated millage tax was the most viable way to finally raise an operating endowment to ensure the museum's survival.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to give a legislative update. We are on the ballot. What we're doing is we're signing contracts with each of the three counties to provide art services. Now, these art services are things that we normally do. And in exchange for that, we are getting operating support. These three counties are becoming our major patrons. One of the quid pro quos that we are offering for this operational support, free general admission to all citizens of the three counties. I'm very excited about the possibility of free admission because obviously that means more people will feel able to come to the DIA. So now I'm going to hand over to Anne-Marie, who's going to give a campaign update.
What people thought about the DIA was that this was a place that held the cultural DNA for all of us, that this was the place that people would come to reconnect. And now we are really activating the campaign. You might have met Eddie McDonald before. Eddie, if you could stand up. Eddie is our overall campaign manager.
Good afternoon.
The DIA brought veteran campaign managers on board to draw up their election strategy.
This is nothing to be overly concerned about. It's something to be overly excited about. You have an opportunity to take the monkey off your back for a lot of years by making sure people vote yes on August the 7th and get out and do what they can to support the DIA.
49 days from today, we will know. This is it. This is when it really begins.
The DIA is considering a possible 0.2 mil tax, similar to the tax that now funds the Detroit Zoo. It's seen as a temporary measure,
during which we will be able to drive our fundraising power from funding operations to building endowment. And a strong endowment will eventually throw off enough interest money so that we can fund operations of this institution.
Additional millages in a tough economy may be a difficult sell.
Through the polling that we did in the years leading up to the millage, was that people in our area had an unusually high degree of civic pride related to the Detroit Institute of Arts that other cities don't have around their art museum.
In a museum setting with cultures and artistic movements compared side by side, traditional art history has always had much in common with the great man theory of history. But creating heroes by minimizing all but a single version of a story may result in a whitewashed history as well as a negative museum experience.
Nobody should be particularly surprised as to why many of the art institutions are heavily Eurocentric, because many of the benefactors are European.
Detroit is America's largest black city, and as the DIA's visitors data revealed, the long-standing cultural biases held by traditional art museums needed to be addressed.
Welcome to the Wassail Feast.
The museum recognized that there's a shift in the U.S. demographic. It recognized that there were people who, when you looked around the museum, there were certain people who were not here.
You can't deny that Detroit is 85% African American. And we come from all shapes and sizes and all colors and hues, and everybody is worthy of being reaffirmed through the art experience, and we've got to find a way to make it relevant to everybody.
The slower an institution is in responding to current trends, the more difficulty it's going to have down the road. It's change or die.
One of the things that I felt Graham seemed to appreciate was the fact that, you know, when I studied art history, I never could study African American art.
The whole question of the history of African American art, I would like to see addressed through the DIA.
African American culture is significant in Detroit. There just seemed to me to be a focus here that we could build upon.
To enable a major museum to start collecting that art and treating it in the same way that we had treated more traditional museum collections.
When Graham and I talked about what I would do for the reinstallation, he got very excited about this idea of teaching people the history of African American art. But we really do keep it in that context of American art.
Not only does the DIA feature the work of black artists, it's the only major art museum with galleries and a curator dedicated to the long-ignored artistic achievements of African Americans.
A lot of the stars in the contemporary art world are African American today, and I want to convey that to our audience. And then the image of this painting showed up, and I just knew as soon as I saw it that it was the right one for Detroit. I really wanted something that does everything this painting does. I mean, you know, showing a young black man in a heroic composition. Historically, it's always shown a heroic European male figure, which is very, very different than black men have been shown. I had black men who work here come up to me and give me a hug and told me they absolutely loved the painting.
I mean, if you're African-American and you grow up in the city of Detroit and you come here and you see someone that looks like you on the wall, that makes you feel good. That gives you hope.
I mean, it's fun on one level, but it really as well does make a very strong statement.
We're not so different. Different education backgrounds, people of different faiths. When you speak to interests that have been historically marginalized or interpreted perhaps through a Eurocentric lens, when you open it opens it up for everyone, not just those people.
That serving plate was right next to us, and how they used the actual serving plate. It was completely interactive and actually incredibly exciting.
One of the museums I love is the DIA. And even when we were in the English aristocracy part, how they used to be served in the nice plates. These displays where you sit and you can, it's very interactive and accessible. And the guard came up to us and said, "Ladies, you came just at the right time. Dessert is being served. But hang on for the first course and you'll see even more."
Are you ready for lunch?
The last person a visitor is likely to meet is me or one of the curators. They're most likely to meet the visitor services and the security people. And so they have to have a sense of ownership and pride, too.
Former Otto executive Nettie Seabrooks, acting as COO during the reinstallation, had some new ideas for the museum security staff. Instead of law enforcement, look to the hospitality industry.
It's no longer that we come into this hallowed place and wait for people to come to us. We meet them where they are and bring them along so that it becomes more important in their lives.
We know that individuals come into museums sort of in a way emotionally hunched over because it's not a natural place. We've taught people to talk quietly in museums, and so it has its own intimidating factors, that a kind of behavior is expected, and that's what we're trying to loosen up.
It's one thing to have someone come to the museum, you know, get them in the first time, but to make them want to come back, to make them feel comfortable, that's another thing. And that depends on how they're treated when they come here the first time. I wanted all the frontline people, security, visitor services, food services, all the people that directly touch people when they come into the museum, to have a common understanding.
Now overseeing all of the museum's frontline staff is Elliot Broom, formerly with Ritz-Carlton Hotels.
Most people wouldn't think, oh, you go from hotel management and now you end up in a museum. But now that I'm here, I see that in many ways they overlap brilliantly. And these are imposing spaces, but beyond the aesthetics, you have the opportunity to really connect with an individual one-on-one.
You want them to have a great time, but you also want them to follow the rules and come in with the museum etiquette. It's just like you go into a department store, you know, one bad experience will make you not want to come back. The way that you talk to a person or treat a person is, first impression is the last impression to me.
We get comments from people that have been to the Louvre, to museums all over the world, and they say, your museum's better. I think the bottom line is, they say they like the DIA better because it's how we make them feel.
Why is it important for people to give and donate to museums? Don't you think that those pictures, sculptures, and documents were important to those people's families? But they were willing to part with them and to give them to a museum so that everybody can appreciate them. So that's what we're talking about. So think about that when we say the greater good. How else could someone, the DIA, acquire an artwork?
Probably because, you know, museums, they try to stick together, like they trade stuff.
Museums loan things to each other. So if maybe the DIA wants something, they can borrow it from another museum somewhere else, from a museum in New York, a museum in France. Is everybody with me?
Most objects in America's art museums are donated. The collections are held in public trust and not owned outright by the museum or the city.
And we get, of course, tethered with the same stuff as the marketplace where they're making a fortune of money on buying and selling art, which has nothing to do with what we do. That does us no good. All it does is make it harder for us to buy things and raise our insurance premiums.
$104 million for Picasso, that's what people begin to see. And so the argument more tends to be, well, you know, you've got four Van Goghs, you know, why don't you just sell one of those because you've still got three? It's a total failure of public trust to do that. It's the most damning admission of failure.
If a museum like the DIA were to close, a legal nightmare would ensue, and many works of art might never see the light of day again.
The majority of the people would be surprised to learn that, you know, the DIA receives no public money at this time, so that's part of our challenge, is making sure that folks understand, you know, the dire situation that we're in. And when we say that, you know, the DIA is at risk of closing their doors, it's quite literal. It's, you know, not necessarily a scare tactic, it's just the, you know, reality of the situation.
This is the Oakland County office. This is where we do a lot of our lawn sign distribution. We opened up at 9 a.m. on Friday, and within 3 hours, I think we pushed out well over 200 lawn signs.
Hello, my name is Deborah, and I'm calling with the Artists for Everyone campaign. We're supporting the ballot measure that would keep the doors open at the Detroit Institute of Arts.
We just gotta make sure that people are showing up.
Good morning.
We have our offices set up now. They're staffed, so that's a real short report. The overall campaign plan has not changed. One thing for sure is July 31st, and that's the GOTV rally. We want to make sure that we got a real nice crowd out there. We're rolling over to Jason in Oakland County.
A lot of activity this week. So to date, we've made 1,910 calls, and that's since we started back in last Monday. We've got 329 positive IDs out of those calls, 78 negatives, and we've been able to get out 976 lawn signs within a couple weeks. So those things are just flying out the door. You know, the big thing is just reminding people they got to vote.
Polling and tracking update. Anne-Marie, any info?
I should have a preliminary report sometime this afternoon. I did ask Melman, I said, you know, if things are going south and you're getting bad numbers, you need to call me right away. And I haven't gotten a call. Okay. So that's the good news.
We're not seeing the opposition. They're out there and they're going to wait right until it counts. The last 10 days, we're going to have a real battle on our hands. So let's not use up all of our enthusiasm and firepower. We've got to run this thing right through the election day. Got to hit it right out of the park.
Okay, we got 19 days to go. A lot of work to do. As we always say, let's go win this.
Yay!
We've got to make this DIA experience so unique and so worthy of celebration that when we have to go to the public and compete for those very, very rare millage dollars, people will prioritize in a different way. People will say, oh no, that's a great institution. That's a unique and wonderful experience. We gotta have it. We've gotta have it.
Important art loans only a museum of their stature can attract were secured in the hope of building support. For $15 a year, over 10 years, Detroit area homeowners could save the DIA.
These are the types of resources that need to be made available to the citizens of the community. It's so important to be able to have something that uplifts and it tells us what is noble about our endeavors as human beings.
I love the tranquility for an artist who had 14 children. It's just amazing.
Vermeer has come to the collection here, and it's an extraordinary experience seeing the Detroit Institute of the Arts at the National Gallery. It's free, and I think that that's the way it should be. We are committed to helping our friends here.
What's your most treasured possession first? Let's hear from some people.
The necklace my great-grandma gave me.
Would you be ever willing to give your treasured possession to someone else?
I said I would not be willing to give my treasured possession to someone else because they could mess it up or they could sell it and get the money for it.
There is no precedent of a city selling a collection in that way. There would be the argument from the Attorney General that you can't liquidate that stuff. It doesn't belong to the city in the way that a fire engine does. It belongs to the public. That's why money was given. That's why the works of art were given. And, you know, we're going to stop you from doing that.
Even though, as a public institution, museum staff could only campaign on their own time by taking the day off, they were still able to make thousands of calls.
Hi, is this Lisa? Hi, Lisa. My name is Elliot, and I'm a volunteer with the Artist for Everyone campaign.
Okay. Thank you. Just to take us off the list. I didn't get a chance to finish.
I'm sorry. You know what?
I was ready to deliver my spiel to Lisa.
I thought you were going to get to.
Were you planning on voting?
Yes, you were.
And there's a ballot measure on there to help save the DIA. Are you familiar with this ballot measure?
There's a ballot measure to keep the doors open at the Detroit Institute of Arts.
Hi, my name is Anne-Marie, and I'm a volunteer with the Art is for Everyone campaign. We support the ballot measure to keep the doors open at the Detroit. Okay, well, thank you for voting. She wasn't
Hello.
Offering.
This message is for the Hughes residents. My name is Elliot.
We're in what's called GOTV Week, which stands for Get Out the Vote Week. And it's just a rally to try to boost our supporters, let them know that we've got 7 days to go.
Really, even Tuesday makes a difference?
Oh yeah, that's the biggest day to do it.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, because even if you call somebody like on a Saturday and tell them, you know, they're supposed to vote, by Tuesday, you know, they're dropping their kids off.
You know, the thing is, like the people who I get where like the voicemails where it's just like no one answers, I actually want to call back. I want to call back and like talk to a live person.
Good evening to everybody, and I'm so pleased to see you all out here for something that's so very, very important, not only to the city of Detroit, but for this entire region.
From a cultural standpoint, we have a very, very rich city. We get people from all across the globe coming here to see and appreciate something that we take for granted. Please tell your family members, your friends, your coworkers how important this is going to be. Please vote yes and support the DIA. Thank you so very much.
I think it's very important to support the arts, no matter how much the cost, to keep the DIA open.
I would be devastated if the museum closed.
And then give us a call if you have any questions.
I'd have to go out of town to another state just to enjoy this type of culture.
To see the DIA go away would almost be like seeing a piece of Detroit go away. It's one of the highlights of even coming to the city. Can I have one of these?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think country without art is country without anything.
Okay. Says where you should pick up your material.
I want the best for the people in this region because I think people doubt that it could be here.
Of course, it's our own livelihood. I mean, there's no question that there's a personal issue, but it also is the support of the institution, the support of, you know, those of us who live in the city. It's so important for us to continue to have that growth. Midtown is doing so well. I think we're there. I'll admit I'm nervous, but hopeful.
Welcome back to Let It Rip. On the panel right now, the Republican for Brunchester Hills, who's accused the DIA of misleading you about its money and about that proposal for a new tax millage. State Rep. Tom McMillan is here. Next to him, his colleague in the State House, Maureen Staples, with us.
They've got $100 million in the bank. You know, they needed a couple million dollars for their loss last year. They could go many, many, many years if this thing doesn't pass.
Well, Maureen, $100 million sounds like a lot of money.
And it is what it is, an endowment.
This gentleman says, well, the DIA has $100 million. You know, they don't need our tax money. They could live off this. Well, yes, we could live off the principal of our operating endowment. And then we would definitely be closed within a couple of years because we would be eating our seed corn. We would starve.
That's when you get into the whole discussion of, well, this is how an endowment works, and this is what this money is for, and by the way, some of these funds are restricted.
Please know that should the millage pass, all residents of the counties where the millage passes will have free general admission to the museum every day the museum is open. So for your son, that will make a huge difference because he won't have any admission fees to pay, and he can come as much as he wants.
Wow, that was a really great call. I mean, like, wow.
She went on to tell me how her son goes down to the museum. He showed me his age, that he loves it.
It's like,
I got a chatty one who was all for it, who wished us luck. That's awesome. I am happy.
And I can say to the museum, I want to give $10 million. But I want it only to go to exhibitions. You have to put it only to exhibitions. You can't decide, well, you know what, we really need a roof, and we can't do exhibitions without a roof, so we really will put it towards the roof. It just doesn't work that way.
I was here this morning, and I took a break, had some other people working, and then I'm back, so stay till the end.
We know this is our shot, and people rise to the occasion because they believe in this work.
Ordered to bed rest with walking pneumonia, Graham ignores his doctor's advice and appears on the news one final time before the polls close.
We got you at 12:08 in the newsroom, so I can come back and get you.
Come on in.
Okay.
Enjoy some water polo, if that's possible.
Some of the numbers being thrown around by the media was scary in that they would encourage people to think, oh, I don't have to vote. They're going to win.
Well,
You should worry about that.
Mm-hmm. Dan will help you with your microphone.
People say, let's face it, after all, you're elite. But I really wanted to say, no, we're not. That's not what the polls show. The polls show exactly the opposite. The polls said everyone goes to the DIA.
We do know that to take another $5 million out of the DI's budget, i.e. go to $20 million, that it effectively closes the museum down.
We can't have that facility boarded up. That is the wrong statement to the rest of the world. It says civilization has collapsed in this region.
Great. Thank you.
Hey, Jason, give me a buzz when you get anything you've got as it relates to 6 o'clock exit polls. Patricia, how are you? Yep, you read my mind. Get me a count at 10 o'clock. Harmony, this is Eddie. Just calling with a reminder. 10 polls, 2 in Mount Clemens, 2 in Sterling Heights, and the other 6 need numbers at 6 o'clock.
2 hours to go.
Talk about the DIA later on. You'll be with us on the webcast, and we'll get around to that really big, important issue in this region.
We don't want to put the city through the humiliation of seeing a internationally recognized museum that Southeast Michigan can't support.
All right, Speaker, thank you for that report. By the way, you have just under 2 hours.
From what we understand, it looks like Oakland County is probably going to come in at about 24%.
About 20% of registered Michigan voters are expected to turn out and cast their ballots on a variety of issues. We have 17 covering out the key returning tonight. So,
campaign headquarters, and I'm going to be here about 6:30 and going back over to the museum.
As the polls close, staff and supporters gather back at the museum.
As we get results about what's happening here in Southeast Michigan, we will bring those results to you.
But I've been back here.
Ground down by the campaign, the exhausted staff nervously wait to hear the final vote count.
You know, I've been telling everybody all day, I'm not going to be confident until all the votes are counted. People who have just come out overwhelmingly in support of this museum, I think really the bigger statement here is that we all join together to support this.
When people ask, how do you feel? I don't want to wish my life away, but I really want it to be over. I want to know.
89.5%. We were out there for several months. We delivered our message to anybody who would listen, and they listened, and they decided that we were important to them, and we were important to the community, and we did bring value to what life is in this region. And I, you know, that was an amazing moment for me, because it's important on some level to know that what you do matters, and people told us it mattered.
This has been a fantastic team effort.
Things are changing in Detroit. Every year, a popular Belgian art magazine leads a cultural tour to New York City. This year, they decided to see what Detroit has to offer.
I guess I would say that we saw the writing on the wall much earlier than others. Nobody can take culture for granted anymore, regardless of whether or not you are an interpreter, a curator, a director. We just have to sort of see that the world around us is really changing.
Weil wir die Sachen lassen.
Achterlaten
können.
Sehr gut.
As an Asian American who studies European art, people have always assumed that I'm a specialist in Asian art. They couldn't figure out the connection. And, you know, at the end of the day, I said art transcends race.
I'm going to encourage you to wander in the American section because that's something that you don't have in Europe, American paintings.
Sure. All objects have multiple stories to tell. It's not about you memorizing, you know, when this or that was made.
The DIA Millage is an excellent example of why you have to build friendships and cultivate relationships before you need them. Imagine a facility like the DIA that embraces and celebrates European art and African-American art and Latino or Hispanic art and Asian art and Arab-American art. That's the uniqueness of the American experience, is the fact that everybody's here and everybody's welcome.
You know, these are things that, again, you can't buy nowadays. If you didn't have them, there's no way you could buy them.
I think the hope for museums lies in our ability to be a real social space and a real civic experience. That's who we are. We exist to support our cities. That's what we do. We meld the global and the local. So we need to become that civic space again. We need to remember that that's who we are.
Such a museum of such high quality. I mean, the pieces of art that we see here are absolutely top quality. We hardly see them in Europe. It's absolutely fascinating for me. On the other hand, we learned quite some negative news regarding Detroit in the press, the problems with the industry, the automobile industry, and so on. But I have to say that I was positively surprised that I see there is a lot going on in Detroit, and we see lots of things moving and changing in a good way.
I'm not surprised that Detroit has turned out in a big way, because I know Detroit, and we're not going to die. We've been down, but we're not out. Dogged determination, Detroit style.
Christie's Auction House is appraising the City of Detroit's art collection. Emergency manager Kevin Orr says appraising the art does not mean it's going to be sold.
I think, you know, what are these paintings? What are they thinking as they hang on the walls and there's nobody in the galleries anymore?